Hello, today I want to show you the settings in Cube3R and what they do. When you're opening your suitcase, on the bottom right you have the settings tab. In the setting tab you have four different tabs. You have a performance tab, a visuals tab, a gameplay tab and a stats tab. Let's start with the performance tab. The first option in the performance is the view distance. By default it's 20 and you can choose between 20, 50, 100, 200 or any. When you change the view distance in your INI, I made a video about here, you can actually decide how far you want to see. I, for instance, have a view distance of 350. The next is the terrain LOD quality. LOD stands for level of detail and it describes how good you can see stuff in the distance. Here you can choose between normal, ultra and INI. The INI is the same as for the view distance, and if you change it to normal, you can see there everything became a lot more blocky and less detailed. Now let's put it to ultra and let's look there. It takes a while because it has to render again. As you could see, it got more detailed and not as blocky as the normal setting. Let me show you again. Look there. Blocky. Going back. Not as blocky anymore. And with your own INI settings you can make it even better and less blocky and more detailed. There. Now it looks a bit strange because it's shadow there. But yeah, as you can see there. Now nice high detail. Back to normal, everything is blocky. The next thing is the shadow quality. That determines how good the shadows from, for example, trees and mountains look. Here you have high and ultra. High, you have shadows, they are there. And ultra, you have really nice looking shadows. The next thing is three distant shadows. This actually determines how good the tree tops look. I have disabled it because when you have a view distance greater than 100, it can happen that your CPU has some problems with the high quality tree shadows. So, the next one is the sky quality. Here you can choose between good and best. With a good quality you have some clouds, everything is nice and looks pretty good. But with the best option you get even more clouds that move separately from the clouds behind and it looks even more natural. Then we have tree distance quality. That determines how good the trees actually looks in the distance. Here you can choose between low and go up to bester. Now, as you can see, the quality of the trees gets definitely better. You can see it on this tree here. Nice tree. Not as nice tree. Really nice trees. Not nice trees. So yeah. So the next option is the light shaft quality. Here you can choose between low to best. The light shaft quality is actually what you can see here. Let's go back to best. The sun rays that go through the treetops. Right now they are really awesome looking and if I put them to low, they are not really that beautiful. So, the next thing we have here is a slider. That's the off the resolution offset. CubeVR has a dynamic resolution. That means if the game determines that your GPU can't have a constant FPS, it actually reduces the resolution. Here you can put the slider completely to the right, then the game will not change the resolution at all and you have the resolution that you yourself put into your Steam and Oculus or Vive software or Windows Mixed Reality software and Pimax software, whatever software that will come in the future. So normally you say you want to have your own super sampling, and here when you put the slider to the complete right, the game will definitely have the resolution, but it can be that you'll lose some FPS. If you put it completely to the left, it's the opposite, and the game will definitely try to keep your FPS constant and will lower the resolution accordingly. So, and if you change the setting, any setting by the way, and you don't know what the default value was, there is a little nice back arrow. When you push this arrow, you can get the setting back to the default. So, the next option is the screenshot resolution. Here you can choose between 4 and 8K. That's actually when you take a screenshot by the in-game screenshot mechanic. To make a screenshot, just press both teleport buttons for about 2 seconds and then you will make 2 screenshots. One screenshot has the bloom effect that you have yourself set for the game, and the second has the better bloom effect, so that you always get a screenshot of what you see and a screenshot of what the game thinks is the best bloom effect. Last option is the safe anti-aliasing performance. Here you can choose between automatic, force on or force off. The anti-aliasing performance is actually some kind of appropriated or better fixed created rendering. So that means in the middle of your view, the screen is really sharp and the image is rendered in best quality that you have chosen. And on the edges of your display, the resolution is a bit less. With this method, you can actually save a lot of resources, especially if you're running on minimal spec requirement. Yes. If you run like a 1060, then you will probably have this safe anti-aliasing performance on automatic or force on. If you record videos like I do, you should actually turn the force up, because in a video you actually notice that the edges of the display are not as sharp as the center. But for normal play you don't notice it, because normally you focus in the center and you normally don't look at the edges of your display. So it's a really nice option to save some resources. So that's all for the performance tab. Next tab is the visual tab. The first option is the bloom. Here you can change the bloom between off up to crazy. A crazy bloom is really crazy, because everything looks really bright, everything is shining. It's a completely different experience. The best bloom settings for the game is actually the best setting. You can actually turn the bloom off if you don't want to have any bloom, but I recommend to at least have the bloom setting to low, because stuff like charging crystals and the furnace looks best with bloom enabled. Next thing we have is the anti-aliasing strength. Here you can change how much you want to have anti-aliasing in the game. Here you can see it on the grass actually. If you change it to the right, you get a lot of anti-aliasing effects, and to the left you get less. So here you can actually change the slider to whatever you want. Actually, I don't like to have the anti-aliasing on a too high level because everything looks a bit washed out on the edges. So I actually like to have it about the middle. Then we have the sharpness. The sharpness actually determines the outlines of the actual stuff. So if you want to have some really nice and sharp looking grass, you can put it to the right. And if you don't want to have the sharp edges of blocks and stuff like the grass, dandelions, the deers, then you can put the sharpness to the left. Next thing we have is saturation. And saturation actually determines how colorful everything is. You can turn the saturation completely to the left, then everything looks a bit more grayish and colorless. That's if you don't want to have some nice vibrant colors. And if you turn the saturation to the complete right, then everything is really bright, really intensive. And yeah, I prefer to have it in the middle because I like the normal colors. Actually, right now it's getting dark, so we can go to the next option, the night darkness. Here you can change between realistic and brighter. If the night is too dark for you because you can't see anything, you can turn it to brighter. And if you want to have a more realistic, darker night, where you almost see nothing, you can turn it to realistic. Then we have the image brightness. Here we can also say if you want to have it a bit on the darker side or on normal. So this actually determines how bright a block is. Like for example, if you place a block in sunlight and it's too bright for you, you can turn it to darker so that it's not as shiny anymore. Then we have torch flickering. No. When you place a torch, it looks like this. When you enable the torch flickering, the light is actually flickering, like you can see here on the edges a bit. It's actually really atmospheric to have the flickering on. I prefer to disable it because the flickering looks a bit like it's stuttering for me. It doesn't stutter, it just looks like it, and that's what I don't like, so I have it turned off. But if you want to have like a romantic candlelight dinner, you can actually turn it on to have it a bit more realistic. Then we have the sunlight shaft brightness. We can make it too boring, then the sun is just there. And if we put it to realistic, the sun is actually shining. And as you can see, the sun is also shining through my fingers and through the cloud that is there. And I think that's really an awesome thing to have. Some people might don't like it. And as you can see here, we even got a shadow cast by our fingers. So I really like to have this one on. Then we have tool hit smoke. When you hit something with a tool, it can produce smoke. And if you're mining a really tight shaft and there are a lot of blocks lying there and you put with your tool against the wall, then there is a lot of smoke and you can't see anything. Here and here you can actually disable the smoke so that you still see where you're mining. That's everything for the visuals. Next tab is the gameplay tab. The first option in the gameplay tab is the invincibility. When you disable the invincibility, your actual health system is enabled. If you want to get fall damage, you can enable this. I have enabled my invincibility, that means I have disabled the health system and now I don't take fall damage. This is actually really nice if you just want to build stuff. Then we have the music volume. Here we can change how loud or quiet the music is. When you want to have your own music in the background, you put it on silent. Then we have the hand size. Here we can determine how big or small our hands in QVR should be. Like now I have really, really tiny hands. There was a rabbit here for scale. Like see, my hand is not even half a rabbit. And if I put it on big, it's over half of the rabbit. So you can actually determine how big your hands should be in QVR. The next option we have is black fade on teleport. When you enable black fade on teleport and you teleport somewhere, you get a really short blackout. It's to prevent getting nauseous. Because I don't get nauseous in VR and I don't teleport that much, I have it disabled. Then we have locomotion fade on teleport. This is something that I have enabled. Then we have the locomotion direction. This is something that determines when you walk around with your thumbstick and in which direction the control goes when you put your controller or your thumbstick upside. If you have it controller oriented, then you will walk in the direction your controller is showing, like shown this way and this. And if you have it to head orientation, you'll go actually where your head is showing. Then we have the turning mode. Here you can choose between snap turn with 22.5 and 45 degrees snaps. So when you're using your right thumbstick, you can actually snap. Or you can put it to smooth to get a nice smooth turn. You can actually determine the smooth turn speed between really fast and pretty slow. Like right now I'm turning and it's really, really slow. I like to have it on default because that's actually a really nice speed. The next thing we have is the smooth loco speed. That's actually your walking speed. So decreasing or increasing your smooth loco speed determines how fast you can walk. Like right now I have it on the lowest setting. And now I have it on the fastest. As you can see, it's faster. It actually makes a difference if you want to explore the world. So I always have it on the highest setting because I like to explore. The next thing we have is black fade on turn. That is when you turn around that you get this black fade out. It is also to prevent nauseous. Then we have the tutorial tab. You can have it hit or visible. The only thing it does is showing you the tutorial on the bottom of your suitcase. Like when it's visible, you have inventory, crafting recipes, tutorial and settings. And if you don't want to see tutorials, you can make it hidden. Or otherwise, if you don't see the tutorial, you can just make it visible. Next thing is the bottom mapping view. With this, you can actually see what the button mapping for your specific controller actually is. I'm using the index controller, so I have my index controller here. And it shows me what all this stuff do. So, after about 2 years playing, I more or less know what each button does, so that's something I don't need. The next and most important option, Astronaut Deer. That's the best option you can have in the game. By default, it is yes. And you can actually turn it off. I would say never turn off astronaut deer. What does it do? If you see a deer, you have a bow and an arrow, and you shoot the deer. You should try to actually hit it. Pew! If you have astronaut deer enabled, the deer actually shoot off into the stratosphere. Pew! And if you disable it, bah, then it's just boring. So, the next setting we have is actually rain. Here you can choose between never, natural, and always. If you have rain on natural, it sometimes starts to rain, it gets cloudy, the rain falls down, then the rain stops, the skies get clear again. It's really nice. If you put it on always, you have always rain. It's really nice if you want to have a nice rainy Sunday afternoon. You can put on always rainy and it always rains. It's nice if you want to have a nice atmosphere in, so let's say, a castle. The same goes for snow, natural and always. Natural, it starts to snow, the snow piles up. Then it stops to snow, the snow melts and everything is okay. And always you get always snow. Then we have the locomotion origin. Here you can change between room, head and falling. Head and falling means that when I fall somewhere down, I can fall down. If you have it to only head and you try to fall down, you can't, because you can't fall down. That's actually pretty useful if you want to build something really high up and you don't want to fall down. Then we have the bucket angle. When you activate your bucket, the bucket normally points upwards. Then you can just point it downwards or in front of you and suck stuff up. But if you think that the actual opening of the bucket is uncomfortable for you, you can actually change the pitch of the bucket, which changes where the bucket is rotated. Like you can actually have the bucket face your face, or you can have it look like a blaster from Mega Man. Then we have the angle. The angle rotates the bucket in this direction and the pitch actually in this direction. So you can change the position of the bucket in every direction that you feel comfortable. So, the next thing we have is the day length. Here you can determine how long or short a day is. If you slide to the left, the days are really short and you can actually see that the sun goes down really fast. And if you make the days longer, the sun will move slower and the day is longer. Same for the night, you can change between short nights and long nights. So that's it for the gameplay tab. The last tab is the stats tab. Here you can actually see your stats from the game. Like for example, you can see on what chunk number you're standing right now. For me it's chunk number 60. Then you have your current location, which is actually really useful. It shows your coordinates in the X and Y position. This is really helpful if you want to explore the world and you want to find your base back. Normally you start your world at the coordinates 0, 0, but if the 0, 0 coordinate is inside or really close to a desert, you will actually start at about 2000 zero, so that you don't start in a desert. Then you can see the total numbers of blocks that you have mined. For me it's 456,000. Then you can see the total numbers of blocks crafted and placed. Then you can see the total mined blocks in the last 10 minutes. That shows you how many blocks you destroyed. Then you see your own record, how many you were able to mine within 10 minutes. For me it's 35,000. And then you have a global rank that's determined on how many blocks you were able to destroy. I'm on the global rank number 5. And then you have the world record, which is actually held by Quoi VR right now with 40,822 blocks. Then you have the button here, generate recipe file. If you want to make your own custom blocks, then you need to have the basic recipe. You put the blocks together, like let's say I want to make a new block consisting of blue grass and a white flower. Then I just click them together, put them on the ground, and then I put generate recipe file. Then it generates a recipe file in your QPR folder that you can use to actually make your own new custom block. And the next option we have is please kill me hard. If you have the health system enabled or your invincibility disabled, you can actually reduce your health by half right now. And now I'm going to please kill me half. So now it actually killed me half. Okay, it reduces my health to 50%. And that's it for the actual stats tab. I hope that I could show you what the... I hope this video was actually helpful for you to understand what the different tabs in your settings do and what the different options in your settings actually do for you. Thanks for watching. Bye!